I love Spielberg. He's my favorite director. His movies aren't perfect, for instance, in terms of intellectual sophistication. They sometimes seem to be lacking. But that doesn't matter. They still hit me viscerally like no other movies do. I feel his movies like no other movies. Even when they are overly sappy and sentimental, they still have a drive and a vigor to them that's unique and that goes a long way to defining the very nature of cinema, at least for me. What other movies feel as full-bloodedly cinematic as Spielberg's? Even the ones that are a bit misjudged and unsuccessful still have at least some measure of that peculiarly Spielbergian energy that I'm addicted to and that gives me life. So we want to try to define that energy as closely as we can, and to that end, we're going to watch each and every one of his films in search of the essence of it. This is Spielberg, The Essay. We're looking at the feature films Spielberg has directed, from Duel in 1971 to Ready Player One in 2018, so we won't look at the television work. If anyone is interested, I refer you to YouTuber Adam Tsansi and his excellent overview of Spielberg's early career. He's doing God's work.
I would like some information. I'm filling out my census form right now, and I have an awful problem.
From the very beginning, we see a surprising commitment to realism in Spielberg. We'll return to this again and again, especially in Jaws, and Spielberg called Jaws, basically,
the sequel to Duel, only it's on the water.
Instead of a man being chased by an evil shark, it's a man being chased by an evil truck driver. Spielberg said this about the realism.
Because I said to him, I'm going to shoot this all on location. And he said to me, you cannot shoot a movie of this scale on location in 10 days. And I said, Wally, I don't want to shoot this if I have to go inside. It's going to look fake. You can look out all the windows of the cars. That won't be a chase. It'll be a guy comfortably sitting on a soundstage with bad process out the windows.
I think he's right. The thing that sells Duel is the landscape and the sense to realize that what this kind of spectacle-driven story requires is a sense of cinematographic realism is the thing that singles out Spielberg, even at this early stage. The thing that I feel isn't entirely in place yet in Duel is the sense of character. The protagonist, David Mann, played by Dennis Weaver, in hindsight clearly looks like Roy Scheider in Jaws, another everyman put upon by a large, unseen force of evil. But compared to Scheider, David Mann just comes across as a bit unpleasant.
Do you think that I should go out and call Steve Henderson up and challenge him to a fist fight or something?
No, of course not. But I think you could have at least said something to the man last night. I mean, after all, he was practically trying to rape me in front of that whole party.
Oh, come on, honey.
And this kind of thing burdens what should be just an abstract exercise in pure tension, and I suspect the 70 minutes television version of Duel is superior to the 90 minutes theatrical version for that reason. The scene with the wife isn't in there, for instance. Still, it's a frankly unbelievable achievement for a 24-year-old to make this in 12 days.
I look back at it, number one, saying, how did I get all those shots and 12 or 13 days. How was that possible?
Interestingly, Spielberg's next movie also begins with a trope of the nagging wife.
I don't want my baby back. Are you gonna help me or not?
Sugarland Express, which is a lovely movie, probably the least known Spielberg film, about a husband and wife who take a young police officer hostage in order to bargain back their child who's been placed in a foster family. Things don't turn out so well, as you can imagine, and it's one of the great strengths of the movie that one can't altogether tell how Spielberg regards this outcome. It's the first time in Spielberg's work a parent is separated from their child, and you'd think that that's what would engage Spielberg's sympathies the most. But for me, the movie's greatest sympathy lies with Clovis, the hapless husband, who's kind of reluctant to embark on this journey to begin with.
And I want to know if you're going to help.
Well, sure I am. Sure I am. Sure I am.
That's the real tragedy of the story. We get a wonderful scene later in the film where a kind of understanding is developing between Clovis and the young police officer.
I've been thinking about getting on the highway patrol.
They won't take a man with a record. I think it's a state law.
Both seem to realize that Clovis could have found himself on the right side of the law, and Spielberg even reinforces this realization with a mirroring shot. The actors even look alike. Doublings, mirrorings, and shadowings are important to Spielberg's directorial style, which we'll see. But Clovis seems resigned to have to follow his wife on her mad quest, and the fact that he never really posed any actual harm is expressed beautifully in the last line, one of the loveliest last lines of any movie.
He took my gun, but he wasn't going to use it.
It's wonderfully subtle and right to let the story end with the police officer and the impact these people made on him. Pretty underrated movie. Jaws is the breakthrough. Yet again, I think it's a question of realism. Imagine if all of this had been shot in a studio water tank, and we wouldn't have had the wide expanse of the horizons signaling the isolation of the characters. The movie wouldn't have been nearly as good. It's a really subtle visual element that is completely indispensable for the tension of the movie, and Spielberg is entirely clear on this.
It is very important that no matter what direction my cameras turned, I didn't want to see land. I felt my fear was, the minute the audience saw land, they'd say, look, this is getting pretty intense out here. Just turn the boat around and go toward that land that we keep seeing in your movie.
With that single decision, Spielberg may well have been to blame for some of the production difficulties with the movie, but it paid off, even if it didn't look like it would. Jaws is, of course, one of the most interesting movies of all time, completely apart from its role in Spielberg's work, simply because, judging from its legendary production, it should have been the least successful movie ever made, and it turned out to be the most successful movie ever made. And it's really not because of the groundbreaking shark effects. We come close to defining a central part of Spielberg's cinematic thinking, which we can call, for lack of a better term, the dynamic between the visible and the hidden. It's interesting that Spielberg came up with this scene with the end of the pier at the script stage before he knew that the shark wasn't going to work. Here he is describing another idea that works according to the same principles.
I had this idea that there's a harbor master, and he's in his little shack, and there's all these sailboats. It's night, and there's about 20 sailboats with just their masts sticking up. One mast starts to go like this. And then the ship next to it, that mast goes like this. And then the third mast goes like this. And the fourth, until all of a sudden you see in sequential order, something is traveling beneath the keels. As the harbor master goes down to clean out his coffee pot in the harbor, and as he gets down to clean out his coffee pot, he, of course, is taken.
This has been referred to as the principle that the scary thing is what you don't see.
I thought that what could really be scary was not seeing the shark.
I think it's more accurate to say that the scary thing is that something implies something else. The thing we see stands in relation to something we don't see, and that relationship is in itself scary. This dynamic also applies to the framing itself, where we have the scary thing and the reaction to the scary thing in the same frame. We can call this premiering staging above editing, and it's one of Spielberg's hallmarks. At his best, Spielberg makes the entire sea feel like it's conspiring to hide the shark. Spielberg phrases this beautifully.
The audience didn't trust me after the first scream, at the end of the first act. And then they were looking out for shadows and things coming out from behind things.
Trust is perfectly put. The mistrust the audience has for Spielberg is exactly the same thing a hyper-imaginative person like Spielberg has for the sea itself, which is probably why he really wanted to make the film and why he was exactly the right person to make it. In that way, the breakdown of the shark played right into his hands in that it freed him to rely on the techniques that he's intuitively drawn to anyway. As Spielberg himself said, the fact that the shark didn't work probably added a great deal to the box office. But that's not all. The thing that truly elevates Jaws beyond the well-made but essentially silly B-movie it by all rights should be is the characters. Here's a question. Why does Quint have to die? My main problem with Duel was that the protagonist David Mann didn't feel entirely sympathetic, despite being bullied by everyone. Spielberg can relate to being bullied, and he has said that all of his early movies about people being
pursued by indomitable forces
was about his fear of the bullies coming after him. The notion of revenge of the nerds is writ large all over Duel, and we can kind of sense it in the opening of Jaws as well, where Spielberg shows us a bunch of trendy young people who he clearly feels he doesn't belong to and who he's kind of lining up as bait for the shark. Chief Brody, however, has none of this. Roy Scheider is just a marvel of sympathy all the way through. We can wager that if Spielberg had made Jaws 30 years later, Tom Hanks would have played him. And in Catch Me If You Can, he kind of does. And Richard Dreyfuss, while a smartass, is genuinely charming in his oddball passion for sharks. The lovely thing about the relationship between them is that they can build a mutual respect on being outsiders.
Doesn't make much sense for a guy who hates the water to live on an island either.
It's the first in a line of wonderful, unlikely bromances in Spielberg, continuing with Liam Neeson and Ben Kingsley in Schindler's List, and maybe even Tom Hanks and Mark Rylance in Bridge of Spies. Quint, however, is a bully. He's kinda the antagonist of the film, and that's why he has to die while Dreyfuss gets to live. I really love this movie, and it's not so much thanks to the adventure on the high seas, great as that is, as I just kinda like to sit at this table, listening to Scheider say,
"I can do anything, I'm the chief of police."
Never gets old. The principle of ordinary objects implying a presence of some kind certainly applies to Close Encounters as well, which is also a masterwork, even though an ambiguous one. I think it's been unfairly overshadowed by E.T., and while E.T. is more accessible, I think Close Encounters is the more profound work, simply because of its ambiguity. Why are the aliens both scary and benign? Spielberg says that the enduring image that remains with him from Close Encounters is the iconic one of the little child opening the door.
When I designed the shot and when I wrote it in the script, for me that was very symbolic of what only a child can do, is to trust the light.
What that interestingly forgets is the tone of abject dread throughout that entire scene. I remember I was shocked by it when I first saw it because I didn't understand why Spielberg wanted to make the aliens he clearly sees as a benign force so frightening. And they remained pretty frightening all the way up to the end. Williams' music signals fear pretty consistently throughout this last scene, or at least wavers between fear and rapture. What does this music express to you, for instance? There's certainly the thrill of discovery there, but there's also a yearning so strong that it might become destructive. That yearning and its destructiveness, I think, is at the heart of Close Encounters. It's infinitely to the credit of Spielberg that he allows that destructiveness to coexist with his benign vision, and the fact that we don't return to Roy Neary's abandoned family doesn't diminish the impact they make. I mean, as frightening as the child abduction scene is, I kind of think this scene is worse.
Right now, we're going.
I always want Terry Garr, who plays the wife here, to be a bit more freaked out than she is, because Dreyfuss is being so frighteningly delusional. I cheer for her when she does the right thing and gets the kids out of there, at the same time as I secretly relish the image of Dreyfuss breaking up the monotony of suburbia by just trashing his house with complete abandon. It's no coincidence that the alien visitation awakens the artistic impulse in him.
Something opens up his imagination to go for something that he thinks is going to provide some cathartic answer. He was an artist trying to plumb the depths of his imagination.
It's basically Spielberg's portrait of the artist as a young man. The fact that Spielberg contrasts that familial discord with the wondrous light of the aliens is what is so captivating, and it gives a backside to these otherworldly creatures that explains why they should also be as frightening as they are. Sure, they come to restore some families, but also to break up others. Spielberg has, of course, said that if he had done Close Encounters today, he wouldn't have allowed Dreyfuss to leave his family. But I think it's extremely important for the intensity of the movie that he lets himself leave. It doesn't make him a good father, but it makes his yearning more irresistible. Speaking of light, Spielberg seems to have a fascination with light in an almost abstract sense. He renders his extraterrestrial visitation in what he calls a
symphony of light and sound and emotion.
He describes the inspiration for this.
You know, I used to park my car, I guess, on Airport Boulevard near LAX, and I used to watch all the planes all stacked up out in the sky, you know, coming in one after the other 5 miles apart. And I used to watch that and say, God, wouldn't that be amazing if I could get that same effect coming into the final zone at the Devil's Tower in Wyoming.
It's a lovely image, Spielberg watching the planes coming in at night and letting that work on his imagination. What are those lights? What could they mean? What could they be? The ambiguity of those lights at a distance is the visual tension that powers Close Encounters, just like the visual tension of the sea and what it's hiding powers Jaws. For instance, if I could ever come up with anything as brilliant as this in my life, I wouldn't really have to do anything else.
All right, let's see. We stop each of the single circuits and lead you right to nowhere.
So So, what's the problem with 1941? Well, as Spielberg says...
We're also missing a lot of humor. You know, we should make this comedy funnier.
Spielberg charitably allows for the fact that the movie might have been better if Robert Zemeckis had directed it himself. But from the evidence of the story, I'm not sure it would have been very good in anyone's hands. The central problem is that there are too many damn characters, which is always because no single character is interesting enough on its own. I recognize that strategy. I've used it myself. It never works. Cinematically, Spielberg clearly saw it mainly as an opportunity to...
break a lot of stuff.
Which can be fun, and if the movie had been 90 minutes of just this... it may have been pretty entertaining in a similar kind of release your frustrations at the monotony of suburbia that we see in Close Encounters, but as it stands, we have about 2 hours of pretty lackluster dialogue until we get there. Maybe we should simply see 1941 as the necessary training ground for the genuinely funny movie to come after it. In a way, Raiders is just as historically revisionist for comedic purposes as 1941 is, perhaps because it doesn't focus on comedy, the humor works much better. As everyone knows, like Star Wars, Indiana Jones satirizes old matinee serials, where there's a cliffhanger around every corner and where ancient civilizations managed to construct some kind of movement sensor for the sole reason of testing the protagonist. Harrison Ford is at least entirely clear on this.
Indiana Jones movies were always more about movies than they were about anything else.
And both Spielberg and Lucas were clear that this was self-consciously a
B-picture.
But just because you self-consciously reference something doesn't mean it's good to reference, especially if the thing you're referencing wasn't very good to begin with. Then you end up with the kind of joke in 1941 Spielberg is describing here.
It was hysterical, but it was so inside. Only I knew it was funny, and only Bob and Bob knew it was funny, that it was the kind of thing that it was better, you know, left out of the movie. It was too much of an inside gag.
The problem with 1941 is, of course, that the whole damn thing is one big inside gag. But Raiders is a bit of an inside gag also, though an entirely successful one. So what's the difference? I think we can trace even Indiana Jones back to a heightened sense of realism, as weird as that sounds. Why does Indy get the shit kicked out of him all the time? I think the best part of Raiders is clearly the truck chase, which is one of the greatest action scenes ever put on film. The moment that always gets me is when Indy gets shot in the arm and the Nazi guy just kind of punches him in the wound. And the way Harrison's body just convulses makes it seem so goddamn painful. And I think that's what's at the heart of Indiana Jones. The way Harrison Ford plays pain and his willingness to play pain makes the films so much more human and real than they otherwise would have been. My favorite moment in the film is this scene, which is interestingly the first time we hear the Indiana Jones theme in full. This makes it feel like some sort of victory lap, but it's not entirely clear what we're celebrating. But it's as if what we're celebrating is simply the persistence, the fact that Indy just goes for it without having a clue what to do. The fact that he's
making this up as I go.
Which is so admirable. I think Spielberg relates deeply to that trait in Indiana Jones, having to make things up on the fly, having to improvise, getting out of bad scrapes just in the nick of time, trying everything and anything. I think Spielberg sees a lot of filmmaking itself as being a bit of an Indiana Jones adventure. We return to Spielberg's preoccupation with the doubling and mirroring. In E.T., it forms the very basis of the story. Elliot and E.T. mirror each other to the extent that they form a telepathic connection. This came directly from Spielberg.
And I was very interested also in that E.T. would communicate often psychically, could be able to reach out to Elliot in school and give him ideas while he was sitting in class.
But why? Why should Elliot and E.T. form this kind of connection? A scene that I had completely forgotten was in the film comes in the middle, the one where E.T. first heals someone. It ends beautifully with E.T. and Elliot both silently watching the mom read Peter Pan to Drew Barrymore. The thematic connection to Peter Pan is pretty clear, you know, flying. But why should E.T. be interested in this vision of parenthood? One of the scariest moments in the film comes when E.T. has become ill. E.T. crying out, "Mom," is clearly due to the psychic connection with Elliot, but it also subtly hints that this longing was already there. E.T., just as much as Elliot, longs for parents, and they both long for a childhood they're about to grow out of, the childhood of Drew Barrymore, who completely believes in the story of Peter Pan, and who so instinctually starts saying,
I do.
I believe that if Spielberg has any religion, the thing he worships is the look on Drew Barrymore's face in this scene. And the way Spielberg tackles this cinematically is to create an environment in which his child actors genuinely could believe in E.T. in this childlike way.
I think Steven, all of his efforts to keep the people that controlled E.T. off the set, so you never were really cognizant of people running E.T. It was just E.T. being.
He applied his cinematic realism to E.T. not first and foremost for the audience's sake, but for the actors. And the result is some of the finest child acting ever put on film. Spielberg said that making E.T. was the thing that made him realize he wanted to be a parent.
I didn't have children back in the early 80s, you know, and suddenly I was becoming a father. And you know, it felt good. And I think I have a big family now because it felt pretty good having three kids back then.
This spills over in an interesting way into Temple of Doom, which is a brilliant movie, fully worthy of Raiders. There's been a general opinion that Temple of Doom somehow represents a dip in quality in the Indiana Jones trilogy. Spielberg himself has opined this.
You know, of all the Raider indie films, Temple of Doom is my least favorite.
This is completely wrong. Temple of Doom is almost as good as Raiders. While it may lack some of the flair of Raiders, Temple of Doom is funnier. It's basically a screwball comedy. People say it's too dark. I rather think that the plot point of Indy basically becoming a zombie isn't very effective. They don't really know how to solve it, so Short Round just kind of throws a torch at him and everything's fine. But everything before and after is comedy gold. It's so appropriate that it begins with a performance of Anything Goes, since that's completely the spirit of the thing. This movie brilliantly achieves what 1941 aimed for, which is a sense of the anarchic. Literally, anything goes. And the thing that makes it work is that it basically revolves around indie parenting. Not only is the plot about bringing back children, the emotional centerpiece of the story is the relationship with Short Round. Indy is like the single dad with his new girlfriend on a really weird vacation, and everyone has to get along while at the same time not getting their hearts ripped out. And what he really wants to do is to just have sex with Kate Capshaw. You know, a bit like Spielberg.
Even though Indiana Jones wound up getting the girl, I really did.
The family dynamic as a source of comedy will of course be gloriously revisited in The Last Crusade, and perhaps not so gloriously in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull.
You cut me and I'll kill you.
The interesting thing about The Color Purple for me, which isn't one of my favorite Spielbergs, I'm afraid, is its approach to sexuality. It's the first time Spielberg deals explicitly with sex, and he has openly admitted that he reduced the sexual element in the book because he was embarrassed by it.
I was just timid. I was just a little embarrassed. I just wasn't the right guy to do that.
Sexuality in Spielberg is difficult because it's generally quite dark. I wonder if part of why he wanted to make The Color Purple to begin with was that he was sympathetic to the extremely troubled portrayal of sexuality in the book, and the reason he shied away from the sexual relationship of Shug and Seeley was that it represented a positive form of sexuality, which didn't really fit with the rest of the movie. In this movie, sexuality is negative, which it tends to be in Spielberg. I think that's why it doesn't really work for me. The quite extreme sexual violence these women endure is harder to reconcile with the generally whimsical tone of the cinematography and music. But that may well be a problem with the source material as well. Empire of the Sun, on the other hand, is one of my favorite Spielbergs, my second favorite to be exact. It's preposterously neglected, and I've thought a lot about why I find it so desperately moving. If The Color Purple is a movie whose ambitions clash with the material it has to work with, Empire of the Sun rather sidesteps that issue by making that very clash the subject of the story. The whole point is that a child experiences war differently from adults, and eventually comes to realize that difference. The film culminates with Jim, played masterfully by the young prodigy Christian Bale, trying to resuscitate his old self in a scene whose unsettlingly dreamlike imagery Spielberg wouldn't return to until his later child-centric masterpiece, AI. Spielberg interprets Jim's journey cinematically by keeping almost religiously to point-of-view shots and experimenting with editing, as in this scene, where Jim realizes his mother may have been taken from their house during the Japanese invasion. Or this one, where Jim, interned in the prison camp, witnesses an attempt at lovemaking.
Oh,
The movie is overall uncommonly rich in terms of imagery. A wide array of symbols echo and allude to each other throughout, creating a kind of tapestry of interlocking images, all tied together by the brilliant script by eminent dramatist Tom Stoppard. Take the opening of the film, one of the most beautiful openings ever, where the camera, face down to the water, sees the coffins of people buried at sea float into the Shanghai harbor. Later, when the British war prisoners have been evacuated from the camp, Jim, in frustration, throws his suitcase of old belongings in the sea, having been abandoned by his American friends who he hoped would rescue him. Finally, when the war has ended and we see Shanghai celebrate, we return to the harbor and see that the suitcase has drifted there as well, having become another coffin, commemorating in its own way the death of something, in this case, of childhood itself. If anyone thought Spielberg was only capable of broad strokes as a director, this movie is the conclusive proof of the opposite, and the true precursor to Schindler's List, as well as a masterpiece in its own right. There's just something desperately moving about this precocious, privileged boy who furiously searches for an identity, wanting to be Japanese, wanting to be American, not even having visited the country that is ostensibly his own, becoming abandoned by everyone, and in the end, has to surrender even the search itself. This is Spielberg's first dramatic masterpiece, and one of my favorite films of all time. The Last Crusade is predictably entertaining, perhaps a bit more sedate than the others, but in exchange a bit wittier.
I'd rather spit in your face. But as I haven't got any spit.
The way Last Crusade renews the formula is, of course, by the introduction of Sean Connery's brilliant comic turn as the father, and maybe the familiar theme of the distant father was what Spielberg needed to compel himself to make a third one. This theme is brilliantly implemented into an action adventure in stuff like this. Otherwise, you can kind of get the feeling that Spielberg felt a bit done with the genre. It always strikes me in Last Crusade how disproportionately well-produced the book-burning scene is, when it's pretty negligent for the plot. Clearly something was eating away at Spielberg, and Schindler's List wasn't far off. Always has been called Spielberg's worst film, and it's probably true. I find there's a basic credibility issue with it. Do I believe any of this? Do I believe Richard Dreyfuss is a great firefighter pilot? Do I believe he and Holly Hunter are passionately in love? I don't think I do, I'm afraid. The one thing that seems weirdly plausible is that Audrey Hepburn is God herself. I can buy into that. There's a conceptual confusion at the heart of Hook, it seems to me. What exactly are we saying about childhood here? Does Peter Banning become a better father by being more childlike? By becoming Peter Pan? But isn't that what Hook does? He's letting the son play baseball and stuff. So what gives? I'm not sure, and I don't think the movie is either. I can't help but think that the only time the movie really flies, if you will, is when we get the flashback to the young Peter Pan, and I wonder why we couldn't just have gotten Spielberg's take on the classic Peter Pan story. It could even have been transposed to modern day, a bit like the BFG, which is kind of an unofficial sequel to Hook. I think that's the problem with Hook, much more than the production design, or that it wasn't a musical. I just don't think Spielberg was entirely sure what he wanted to say here. It's easy to detect some form of self-reproach in Spielberg's depiction of Peter Banning, the father who works all the damn time. An even more interesting form of self-reproach comes in the shape of John Hammond, played charmingly by fellow director Richard Attenborough. It's interesting that both Jurassic Park and Hook have complete contempt for lawyers.
I am a lawyer.
Kill the lawyer!
And the only one I've got on my side is the blood-sucking lawyer.
Thank you.
But what's Jurassic Park really about, except for being simply an excuse to have dinosaurs in a movie? It's interesting that Spielberg's dinosaur movie takes the shape of an anxious, almost conservative denouncement of technology. The irony is that the film utilizes the most advanced technology available in order to throw doubt on that same technology. The central scene is this one.
This place... I wanted to show them something that wasn't an illusion. Something that was real.
Hammond evidently feels like a fraud, and the dark implication of his lines here is that making the dinosaurs dangerous is the price you have to pay in order to make them
real.
Most of the problems in Jurassic Park could have been avoided relatively easily, it seems to me, if they had decided to only breed the nice dinosaurs. I mean, just breed these guys and everything's fine. But no, Hammond knows, and Spielberg knows, that the audience wants the T-Rex. In that way, Jurassic Park is a bit conservative and almost cynical in its attitude towards the masses, in a way that I kind of respect. It shows a turn towards something darker in Spielberg, which feels like a natural development. Cinematically, Spielberg manifests the realism of his dinosaurs by a very simple yet extremely effective technique. Always let the CGI characters interact with physical objects. It's the performance of the practical effect that will sell the reality of the digital effect. This is a lesson that most directors still haven't learned about CGI almost 30 years later, and it demonstrates extremely well what it is that makes Spielberg's action just feel a bit extra, you know what I mean?
The presentation.
Schindler's List is another breakthrough. Spielberg completely renews his style, as he describes himself.
I took an approach of a documentarian. I tried to make the camera as much a part of the storytelling. I just created the scene with the actors, and then I would just wander into the scene like I was an eavesdropper with the camera to try to make the existence of the camera very second nature to what was happening in front of the camera.
And in the process invents a cinematic way of approaching history that will follow him through his latter career. We've traced a through line of realism in Spielberg's work, surprisingly so, since what he usually applies that realism to is wild invention and fantasy. Now he finally applies it to actual history, and the results are riveting. This most often manifests itself through the handheld camera, but it isn't simply a trite matter of shake the camera a bit so it looks a bit like a documentary, as if that isn't also just Hollywood artifice. Anyone can do that and say it's realism. No, it's the way the camera is performed to react to the chaos on screen. The camera is reactive to the events. It acts just as much as the actors do. That suggests a profound vision of cinematic realism that I think in some ways is original to Spielberg, or at least harkens back to the old masters. Martin Scorsese said of the old Howard Hawks film Land of the Pharaohs that it's like watching a
documentary made on location 2800 years BC.
Occasionally, I think Spielberg has the audacity to believe that he's traveling back in time too, and the miracle is that he actually seems to achieve it. You do feel like you're there. And it's not like Spielberg sacrifices his usual facility with staging by constraining himself to this documentarian style. It's rather that his compositions become even more deft and fluid by this stylistic renewal. This is a director whose intuitions about cinema have become so fine-tuned that he is now willing to trust those intuitions. Ben Kingsley perfectly described the director who was
filming from your gut.
Liam Neeson compared him to an
abstract painter.
And Ralph Fiennes says he's never experienced that
level of energy and focus
from a director before. The actors seem to speak of a man possessed, and you can feel that from the movie. There's an angry man behind the camera, and it's exhilarating to watch, even when the subject is as devastating as it is. It's that rage that gives the film its great dignity, a kind of dignity, which is exactly what is required if one is to dramatize or reenact this material at all. I think Spielberg understood that and used it, and that's why Schindler's List represents one of the most perfect marriages of style and substance in the history of film. A perfect marriage seems ironic in the context of Spielberg films, but there it is. Going from Schindler's List to Jurassic Park 2 feels like a bit of a joke, but that's Spielberg for you. What other director could possibly have made Jurassic Park and Schindler's List in the span of a single year? That should be enough to convince you of the uniqueness of Spielberg and the necessity of studying his work. But The Lost World basically exists for the sole reason to let a T-Rex run loose in San Diego, which is fun enough. I could have used a bit more of it, in fact. It does amp up the cynicism of the original in a way that I rather enjoy.
Oh yeah, ooh, ah, that's how it always starts.
And the scene with the truck hanging is hilarious, straight out of Indiana Jones. The Jurassic Park movies are basically just Indiana Jones movies set in the modern day anyway.
Did Christ hire a lawyer to get him off on technicalities? He went to the cross, nobly. You know why? To make a statement. But Christ lost.
The The striking thing about Amistad is its opening, in which we see Spielberg edge closer to the fury he'll unleash in Saving Private Ryan. Amistad is essentially a courtroom drama about the legal ramifications of a slave rebellion aboard the slave vessel La Amistad, and Spielberg begins the film with the rebellion itself. The violence is gruesome and nasty, but the remarkable thing is the sense that Spielberg finds it completely justified. We're rooting for Jaiman Hansu as he commits this violence, which I find daring and intriguing. The crucial line in support of this comes in the verdict of the Supreme Court at the end.
We are then left with the alternative that they are not slaves, but are rather free individuals with certain legal and moral rights, including the right to engage in insurrection against those who would deny them their freedom.
The right to insurrection is the thing that's so forcefully expressed in the opening scene, and which justifies the near relish of the violence. The movie would have gained from some more of this, I think. While the rest of the movie is by no means bad, I think the courtroom drama plays a bit worse than it does in Amistad's successor, Lincoln, partly because I feel the historical reenactment isn't as handsomely mounted. Just compare Amistad's recreation of the Civil War with Lincoln's, and the difference is obvious. But Amistad shouldn't be dismissed. Its brief depiction of the horrors of the slave trade is rightly harrowing, and the only problem with it is that it's brief. Spielberg demonstrates that we could have gotten a Schindler's List of the slave trade, and it's kind of a shame we didn't. It might be one of the best renditions of slavery on film. And speaking of best depictions on film, has anyone really even come close to equaling Saving Private Ryan in the depiction of warfare? Every war movie after it has tried to be it, it basically created its own genre of video games. Spielberg yet again applies the techniques of Schindler's List to the reenactment of history, but instead of being simply documentarian, the effect is almost like VR. At times you can sense the literal identification of the camera with a person, like in the brilliant detail of the camera not managing to stay above water. This may well have been influenced by Spielberg's own gaming. Just listen here when he describes 1941.
Looking back on the movie, one of the most enjoyable things about the film for me is that the film is pretty much no different than playing Doom 2 or on your computer today.
The comparison of the nonsense of 1941 to the splatter comedy of Doom seems apt, but Saving Private Ryan applies the immersion of the first-person shooter to much more serious ends, a seriousness of purpose which your Call of Duty and your Medal of Honor, perhaps with mixed results, has tried to emulate. This immersiveness, like the aliens of Close Encounters, is ambiguous. I do think something in Spielberg is profoundly drawn to the utter chaos of the battlefield, at the same time as being utterly terrified by it. Here the great critic Mark Cussons questions Spielberg about the elements of power fantasy in the portrayal of war, and I think Spielberg becomes noticeably defensive.
Could war movies be a kind of fantasy fulfillment for men who felt marginalized from the group of guys?
Well, you know, I guess they could.
Maybe it was like that for you?
I don't know, you know, I was certainly an outsider. But a lot of my films weren't just war films.
Spielberg has admitted how ashamed he felt of how much pure fun he had making this movie, playing war. And some of that relish probably accounts for the enormous vigor of the filmmaking. At the same time, he's completely open with the fact that his surrogate in the movie isn't the heroic Tom Hanks, but rather the meek and ineffectual Upham.
I told Tom Hanks one day, I said, you know, you think I'm you. I want to be you in this picture. I would like to be you, or I'd like to be Sarge. But I think I'm more like Upham.
So to what extent is the combat in Saving Private Ryan a power fantasy? To some extent, clearly, just like real war to some extent is a power fantasy for many who partake in it. It's important to note that just because something is a power fantasy doesn't necessarily mean that it's less truthful to historical fact. The historical fact itself may be deeply distasteful to us, and we may reasonably question the motives for portraying it, but its truthfulness may still be entirely intact. However, I don't think the core interest of Saving Private Ryan is power, any more than its fantasy. What I so profoundly appreciate about the movie's depiction of warfare, and that I don't really see anywhere else, is the sense of utter futility of it. No other movie captures so well that it's basically impossible to survive, and if you do, you had nothing to do with it. Giovanni Ribisi expresses this very forcefully.
Just give us a fucking chance, you son of a bitch!
Wait!
Son of a fucking
come on!
That's exactly the point. A chance is what none of these people will ever get, and what Spielberg denies both himself and the audience. That's why it strikes so many as the finest representation of war on film. It's worth noting, however, that a lot of the techniques Spielberg uses to impress this don't substantially differ from his entertainment films. Take the ruthless scene of the stabbing, for instance, when they roll over the bleeding guy back and forth. That kind of detail could easily have been a joke in an Indiana Jones movie, while here it instead comes across as the cruelty of war itself. One might consider it disrespectful to treat historical reality with the same kind of flippancy one brings to adventure fiction, just like one might find the documentary style of Schindler's List disrespectful in its presupposition that there can be such a thing as a realistic depiction of the Holocaust. I rather think that it's a kind of a weird miracle that Spielberg realized that his great proficiency with rip-roaring adventure could be subverted into capturing something of the real-life terror of historical events. Spielberg describes the cinematographic techniques that make the film, as he beautifully puts it, nervous to look at.
Desaturate the color. The film is in color, but the film is very faded, so the film looks authentically period. I shot with an open shot, with a 45 and 90 degree shutter, camera shutter. What that does is it deglamorizes sequences by getting rid of all out of focus blurring. That coupled with my vibrating camera, I had a vibrating lens called a shaker lens on top of our other lenses, and I could press a button electrically and create a shake in the lens and take my finger off the button, the shaking would stop. All those things made the film nervous to look at.
Like I said, one might, if one is so inclined, think of these as gimmicks, cheap tricks to make something seem realistic, while it's actually just a more luxurious version of a typical Hollywood thrill ride. I think the complete opposite. I think Spielberg has accurately identified subtle visual elements that can express something of the feeling of what it was like, while not actually expressing the thing itself. The way Spielberg makes the physical effort of filming itself seen through the image is almost modernist in its implication, which is also surprising. One doesn't associate Spielberg with either realism or modernism, but I think the comparison holds. That's why Spielberg isn't just a great filmmaker, he's an important one. AI is a profoundly difficult film, not least because it's unclear what came from Spielberg and what came from Kubrick. Spielberg corrected the critics who mistook the ending to be Spielberg's invention when it in actuality was Kubrick's, but I can't understand how those critics made that mistake in the first place. The ending is clearly Kubrickian, something about these higher beings creating a familiar space for this creature they've unearthed certainly recalls 2001, wouldn't you say? No matter, the film is still very much a Spielberg film, even though it's hard to know to exactly what degree Spielberg tried to emulate Kubrick's pre-production work and to what degree he allowed himself to deviate from it. Apparently Spielberg kept pretty close to the existing version of the screenplay, but made
hundreds of changes, nevertheless,
in his own version. I'd love to know what they are, but most importantly, Spielberg himself expressed it like this.
The hard thing about making AI, I didn't want to lose myself and just, slave and service Stanley's vision. I had to put as much of myself in this project as I could to also make it worth my while, because this wasn't a charity case. I wasn't doing this for charity.
By this, he makes it clear that he realized the necessity of making the project his own, and he definitely succeeded. The result is probably one of his finest films, containing some of his profoundest imagery. He revisits images from his previous work, like the child imitating the parent at the table from Jaws, or the enraptured face watching another child being told a story from E.T. By the context of this story, these images are newly charged with irony, and this irony may be the film's greatest strength, and in a way its least Spielbergian trait. In Jaws, the child imitating Brody at the table subtly conveys the child wanting to become closer to the distant father, who at first is unaware of being imitated. But in AI, the irony of this is enhanced by the robot child being unable to eat, therefore being even unable to correctly imitate the parent. In E.T., E.T. and Elliot gazing at Drew Barrymore believing in the fairy tale subtly conveys a sense of fading innocence. In AI, this is turned to irony in that the robot child, who is supposed to be unable to believe, is the one believing in Pinocchio, while at the same time being passed over for the human child, who doesn't believe. This irony makes the film uneasy and unnerving to watch, but also captivating. One of Spielberg's grandest images comes when David, played to a kind of uncanny perfection by Haley Joel Osment, reaches his manufacturing place in New York and looks into the mask of himself. The loaded symbolism of this is hard to unpack, the symbols of faces, eyes, sight, and doubling all intertwining. The existential nature of it is almost like Bergman, you know what I mean? I wonder if Spielberg invented these images. My suspicion is he did, and in any case, he was the one who realized them. What is ultimately most Spielbergian about the movie, as opposed to Kubrickian, perhaps, is the deep sympathy it has for its poor robots and the accompanying fear it has for its humans. The film's final irony is, of course, that the robots are more human than the humans.
The most lasting proof of their genius.
As the film beautifully and somewhat mournfully puts it. Minority Report, another one of my favorite Spielbergs, continues imagining dark futures, but applies an even greater realism to the endeavor. Spielberg basically asked a team of scientists to accurately predict what the future was going to be like, and they were mostly kind of right. It is a model in terms of world building. It always looks more like the present day than it looks like sci-fi, which is a fantastically good idea, and I can't really think of any other film that really feels like it in that respect. You can see traces of its influence in other stuff, but it still seems pretty unique to me. More importantly, it's almost entirely visual. We learn what these things are, or these, simply by looking at how they work, and it's brilliant entertainment. This entire chase basically amounts to a sci-fi Indiana Jones, and I love it so much. There's a general sense of experimentation going on here, and all throughout Spielberg's post-9/11 period, which to me produces some of his finest and most intriguing work. The bleached quality of the cinematography makes it seem both ominous and oddly beautiful, and the self-destructive intensity of Tom Cruise adds a very attractive edge to Spielberg's sentiment. My favorite scene might be the one where Cruise is just obsessively looking at his home videos, reciting all the words.
Gotta keep running.
Gotta keep running. Gotta keep running.
There's a sense of not being able to stop running that reoccurs all throughout this latter stage of Spielberg's work, and that probably says something of his mindset at the time. I find it deeply relatable, as I do Spielberg's next movie.
Look. Frank. Nobody's chasing you.
Speaking of being on the run, I mentioned Empire of the Sun being my second favorite Spielberg film. We arrive at my number one favorite. Catch Me If You Can was the movie that convinced me all of Spielberg's movies were worth exploring. I only saw it because I noticed, hey, Spielberg's directed this, maybe this is worth watching. And it was a revelation. My parents got divorced when I was almost exactly the same age Spielberg was when his parents got divorced, and it's a really weird thing to try to make sense of, as every child of divorced parents knows. That weirdness is exactly what this movie is about. The desperate running away and the longing to get caught. The running away in order to get caught. This seems to me one of Spielberg's most profoundly personal films that grapples with a broken family as openly as he has ever allowed himself. Every scene between DiCaprio and Walken plays devastatingly for me. The ambivalence between them, the need to connect, the need to impress, the begrudging recognition, the secret understanding. All of it drenched in the almost expressionist lighting Spielberg began using in AI. Here, where the son directly reaches out to his father, Spielberg turns them both into shadows, maybe of each other.
Then ask me to stop. You can't stop.
Maybe the reason the movie is so beautiful is because Spielberg now can identify so thoroughly with both DiCaprio's lost boy and Tom Hanks' workaholic father figure. One of the finest and weirdest things about the film is its extended ending, full of false starts until they realize they're both missing a family.
You're just a kid.
I'm not your kid. You said you were going to Chicago.
My daughter can't see me this weekend. She's going skiing.
You said she was 4 years old. You're lying.
She was far when I left.
It's a bit like Spielberg is unwilling to leave these characters. As am I. All of the movies around this time revolve around images related to 9/11, so we stick around in airports. In a way, you could regard The Terminal as another attempt at always, yet again romance is related to air travel. In a deeper sense, it's a continuation of the concerns of Catch Me If You Can. It's about survivalism through ingenuity, and in an even deeper sense, it's about the issues of translation that has interested Spielberg since Close Encounters, all the way through Amistad. Translation is for Spielberg also very much a matter of ingenuity.
I think the greatest thing is when people at least make an effort to communicate, and when the person doesn't get it, you have to try harder and be resourceful and inventive in finding different ways to get your message across.
And while The Terminal isn't about being on the run, its predicament is similarly desperate, being stuck. I think it's kind of charming. It doesn't have the central credibility problem of Always, in that I can actually kind of believe that Tom Hanks is East European, but I'm still unsure if Catherine Zeta-Jones's flight attendant would be very much interested in him. The most convincing love story here is between Zoe Saldana and Diego Luna. I love them.
You're an asshole. I hate coming here.
Why you act like such a dick?
War of the Worlds may be one of Spielberg's best films, and certainly one of my favorites. Its portrayal of a father-son relationship that is just openly resentful is cathartic, and its sense of urban and military realism is basically unmatched in the genre. We return to the insight we first noticed in Duel. The way to make your fantasy work is to make the realistic parts of the fantasy as realistic as you can. It's just brimming with unresolved horror at terrorism, the way the cityscape can instantly turn into a war zone. At its most intense, it's almost like a cross between Close Encounters and Saving Private Ryan, as weird as that sounds. The hidden point is, of course, that the people almost pose as much of a threat as the aliens. The scariest scene is the one in the car, and it powerfully expresses an intense fear of crowds in Spielberg, which we haven't really seen before. This, like AI and Minority Report before it, is as unlikely a thing as a science fiction film for grown-ups. With Munich, Spielberg's dark period culminates, and predictably it's another one of my top five favorite Spielbergs. I, of course, know nothing of its accuracy, but the writing is subtle, and Spielberg fills it with great location shooting. I wonder where Spielberg's final sympathies lie here. The brilliantly tense assassination sequences read to me like Spielberg finds it a bit too easy to imagine the stress he himself would feel under these circumstances. Question is what he thinks of his patriotic duty to partake in them. Avner doesn't exactly seem pro-Israel by the end of the movie, and I think the movie itself agrees with him. I at least have a hard time interpreting it any other way. At the same time, there is a fraternity among these Jews that Spielberg makes genuinely lovely, and maybe that tension accounts for the profound bitterness of the film. Spielberg's bitterest work, even worse than Schindler's List in some respects. Interestingly and worryingly, this bitterness takes on a sexual dimension. We return to the subject of sexuality in Spielberg. This is about as dark as it gets. The ending scene where Spielberg contrasts Avner attempting to have intercourse with his wife with the scenes of the Munich massacre intruding into his consciousness is provocative enough. But even more disturbing is the killing of the Dutch assassin, which contrasts the sexual and the violent even more obscenely. This is Spielberg's most pitch black imagery, and I really don't know how to interpret it. In the end, Avner's issue is also not being able to stop running.
I knew guys like you in the army. You do any terrifying thing you're asked to do, but you have to do it running. You think you can outrun your fears, your doubts? The only thing that really scares you guys is stillness.
Maybe Spielberg implies that there is too much obsessive running away in our sexuality as well, and he may well be right. But I cherish these lines delivered so beautifully by Kieran Hines. They remind me of something at least I regularly need to hear. Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is fine. It's perfectly fine. If Last Crusade was a bit more sedate than its predecessors, Crystal Skull is even more so. But there's still good stuff here. Like the fridge. It's stupid, but it's fun. And it's not like Spielberg doesn't know what he's doing.
I know in Indy 4 you didn't buy the refrigerator and the atomic bomb. I know.
And the bike chase demonstrates that Spielberg has no problem still doing stuff like this. The problem with the second half is yet again that there are too many characters that don't have anything to do. John Hurt gets to just kind of sit there. The best part has always been this little sneak preview of West Side Story.
Get that greaser!
We see in this latest phase of Spielberg's work a return to the 1950s of his childhood, befitting an artist in his later years. If anyone was disappointed by Crystal Skull, Tintin kinda makes up for it. Admittedly, it is a kid's film and not a bad one, but there's still good stuff in here for the action lover. The massive long take at the end is enough to justify the whole thing. You can kinda get the sense that Spielberg finally gets to try stuff that he's been wanting to do for his entire career, but that has been physically impossible. I guess that's really the point of performance capture, to get at a kind of weird hybrid between photography and animation so that the movements of the characters have realistic weight to them, while at the same time existing in impossible scenarios. Part of me wants an Indiana Jones film like this, part of me doesn't.
Ready, go!
War Horse is one of Spielberg's most bizarre movies. I once quipped that it's the movie that goes from My Little Pony to Saving Private Ryan in 90 minutes, and while that's clearly a joke, I don't think it's that far off. The beginning is almost absurdly cute, and as soon as we get to the trenches, we at least sense the fury we know Spielberg is capable of, and that I think he almost strains to rein in a bit. We get a sense of this all throughout Spielberg's post-Private Ryan work, in Munich, in Lincoln, in The Post, that Spielberg can't help himself from going back to directing Warfare, but that he can only allow himself a few minutes of it, lest he gets swept along by the pure force of it and it takes over the entire film. I must admit, I kind of want that to happen, but I still like War Horse, even though I'm not really sure the movie is very well written or even has a particularly good story. I'm just not sure I'm entirely convinced of the inordinate love everyone bears for this. To my eyes, perfectly ordinary horse, so to make the horse the symbol of the innocence threatened by the onset of war doesn't work nearly as well as making Matt Damon that same symbol. The thing that makes the film work, and I still really think it works, is the landscape, and Spielberg really revels in it. You can feel the infatuation he has for it in the frame. The landscape becomes for the viewer, I think, what the horse becomes to the boy, a worthy symbol of that innocence. I mean, when we get to this part, this is just absurdly overdone, but I still love it, I can't help it. There's a wonderful documentary about Cecil B. DeMille, and of course Spielberg shows up in it, and he has this to say.
No one got near the DeMille style. No one dared to. They probably were embarrassed a little bit by walking not only in his giant shadow, but by treading in an area that didn't make other filmmakers comfortable. That kind of operatic style.
In War Horse, we finally get the sense of Spielberg embracing his own DeMille-like sense of opera, without any shame at all, and it's exactly the shamelessness of this that I love so much. Spielberg's greatest achievement in cinema history may in the end be to have merged the two utterly dissimilar sentiments of, on the one hand, François Truffaut, and on the other, Cecil B. DeMille. As idiotic as that sounds. Lincoln is at least an extremely well-written film, courtesy of the fine dramatist Tony Kushner, who likewise penned Munich for Spielberg, and who has now become one of his closest co-workers. Occasionally, it might even be too well-written. I could have used a bit more basic explanation of the workings of Congress in the 1860s, but that's on me rather than the film. I do think I grasp the central argument put to Lincoln by the Confederate Vice President, played slyly by Jackie Earle Haley.
Have you held your union together? Through democracy? How many hundreds of thousands have died during your administration? Your union, sir, is bonded in cannon fire and death.
The central line is, how have you held your union together? It takes on a certain weight after the movie has shown us the occasionally deceptive methods Lincoln has resorted to in order to pass the amendment. Lincoln's reply also doesn't strike me as entirely convincing, or indeed convinced.
But say all we've done is show the world that democracy isn't chaos, that there is a great invisible strength in a people's union. Say we've shown that a people can endure awful sacrifice and yet cohere? Mightn't that save at least the idea of democracy to aspire to?
The thing Lincoln, by his countenance, has shown rather more throughout the film is his weariness and growing impatience with the political process.
You will procure me these votes.
For a noble cause, yes, but still impatience. The perhaps finest thing about Daniel Day-Lewis's genuinely great performance is the constant note of melancholy he captures in the man. The suggestion is that the wisdom and melancholy were inseparable. Consequently, the thing that moves me most about the film is the strained relationship with the elder son, played just wonderfully by Joseph Gordon-Levitt. He's the one that stands out for me in a movie almost absurdly filled with great acting.
I have to do this, and I will, or I will feel ashamed of myself for the rest of my life. Whether or not you fought is what's gonna matter, and not just to other people, but to myself. I won't be you, Pa, I can't do that, but I don't want to be nothing.
I could have taken a bit more of this. Lincoln as portrayed is so captivating a character that I could have easily taken just more of his personal relations and less of simply his politics. But that's due to an embarrassment of riches.
You don't seem alarmed.
Would it help?
Bridge of Spies returns us to the world of espionage and covert operations of Munich, but in the style of the chamber piece of Lincoln. Question is yet again where Spielberg places himself in this somewhat ungainly narrative material. Tom Hanks most often represents the ideal to which Spielberg aspires more than himself, and the introduction of Mark Rylance into Spielberg's work is clearly significant, if enigmatic. I think Rylance as the perpetually stoic spy Abel more represents an ideal of stillness for the perpetually on-the-run Spielberg. Spielberg, like the Ben Kingsley of Schindler's List, a stillness I think he's attracted to, like the moral steadfastness of Hex. But the character whose predicament Spielberg most intently empathizes with is, I think, Gary Powers, the failed soldier, like Upham, who fails at his patriotic duty, by implication because he's uncomfortable with the moral implications of that duty. We return to the predicament of Eric Bana's Avner in Munich, who struggles with having to perform unrighteous acts for a righteous cause. For me, it lacks the sting of Munich, maybe because it's hard to imagine the moral certitude of Tom Hanks existing within that film. But it's interesting that Spielberg is investigating the limits of his own patriotism. I'd just like it to go further. Mark Rylance definitely gets to be Spielberg's stand-in in the BFG, the bullied dream catcher of a giant, and it's a wonderful performance of genuine children's theater. So good that I kind of wish I could see Rylance himself doing it and not the animated monstrosity he's disguised as. Alright, that's mean. Alright, I don't mean that. It's a very well-animated film, but also kind of over-animated, you know, the way Hook is clearly overproduced. I rarely find it an especially beautiful film to look at, even though very imaginative and charming. Do we really need realistic skin complexion in a kid's film? I'm not sure. Or maybe it's just that the earthy and decidedly low-tech environment of the Giants doesn't meld very well with the digital sheen of the animation. Ready Player One fares better in that respect. Here is the first time I wonder if the realistic principle we've located in Spielberg might actually have been a drawback rather than a boon. The most charming part of the film is this lovely and very low-tech shadow play, recalling Hook again. I could have used more of that.
You are losing female readership, you know, and I think you might want to focus more on what women...
Catherine, keep your finger out of my eye.
The Post is the next step in Spielberg's investigation of the limits of patriotism, or indeed the demands of patriotism. The most interesting thing about the film is the sense of regret these influential people finally experience.
The days of us all smoking cigars together down on Pennsylvania Avenue were over. The way they lied, those days have to be over.
Both Streep and Hanks come to realize that their association with high and mighty politicians may have blinded them to some extent. And I wonder if Spielberg relates to that. He has also become a powerful and influential figure at this point. I can appreciate the movie's sense of the time for a reckoning having come, while at the same time being amused by the fact that what Spielberg seems most excited by is the desperately old-fashioned printing machine itself. A sense of reckoning can yet again be read into Ready Player One, similarly to Jurassic Park. Mark Rylance, in what I think is his best performance yet for Spielberg, clearly stands in for Spielberg as the impresario of a gigantic entertainment empire who is also a hopeless misfit and who seems to be having some doubts as to his legacy. He tries to make up for it a bit in the ending.
Because reality is real.
But no one's really convinced. This attempt at contriteness is utterly belied by the fact of how much fun Spielberg is having here. The car race is for me one of the absolute best things that Spielberg has ever directed, and is probably the single best use of this type of photorealistic animation ever. No one but Spielberg would even come close to making this, and the fact that he can still do stuff like this at this point is further proof of his uniqueness. So while the story of Ready Player One is kind of okay, and the mechanics of the world don't even make the slightest bit of sense, it also doesn't even remotely matter. The energy of this, the pure chutzpah of it, is unrivaled, and so we return to our opening claim. So, what do we learn? Well, for one thing, we've established a vital strain of realism running all the way through Spielberg's work. A sense of heightened realism is the thing that unites such disparate efforts as both Jaws on the one hand and Schindler's List on the other. And if we feel, like a lot of us probably do, that some part of Spielberg is almost synonymous with cinema itself, then that may well be because realism is also inscribed into the very nature of the art form. Film is made, at least photographic film, by capturing reality. And in any case, I think that the extraordinary energy we feel in Spielberg's films derives from a conviction in this essential realism of cinema, and the supreme staging he showcases is designed around that conviction. He tends to save his longest and most intricate takes for his most spectacular effects to impress the reality of them, as it were. But how then do we reconcile the fantasist Spielberg with a realist? The point is, I think, yet again, the contrast of a close attention to the real world with the intrusion into that world of a fundamentally alien force. The everyday has to feel almost overbearingly ordinary for the intrusion of the spectacular to have any force at all. This creates a duality or mirroring in Spielberg himself. The familiarity of the real world reinforces the spectacle of the fantasy, and the fantasy in turn grounds the familiarity of the real world. This can work the other way around as well. The rough texture of E.T. can almost strike one as an instance of gritty realism, while the suburban childhood home can seem like the otherworldly fantasy. This goes for the direction too. It's not so much the shark that's the special effect, it's the sea, and Richard Dreyfuss has this wonderful thing to say.
I was hired in those days, seriously, because I had the ability to go. There was nothing there.
That's really the point. It's not so much the alien that's the special effect, or the dinosaur. It's the look on Dreyfuss's face, or Sam Neill's, that's the true special effect. Jeff Goldblum describes being directed by Spielberg, and it demonstrates the care Spielberg takes in shaping the very expression on a person's face.
And we did close-ups, and I remember he'd never rehearse. Ready, Jeff? Okay, there you are. You're seeing the dinosaur. Oh my gosh, just keep rolling.
That looks great.
You're looking at it. You can't believe what you're seeing. Is it real? It now strikes you funny. You don't even know why. You know, and he's just talking me through it and I'm kind of acting.
Tom Hiddleston describes another instance of this sculpting of the face.
Stephen gave me the most amazing note, actually. He said, give me your war face and the camera's gonna move across. And as you feel it come up in front of you, I want you to de-age yourself by 20 years. So you're 29, and then when you see those machine guns, you're 9 years old. I want to see the child in you.
That realization of the need for a human response to unreal spectacle is what makes Spielberg one of the finest of all cinematic fantasists. J.J. Abrams, one of the more successful of Spielberg's disciples, sums it up pretty well.
You're not supposed to rip off the shark or the monster. You gotta rip off, you know, if you rip something off, rip off the character.
So that's the fantasy side of Spielberg, while the realism side of Spielberg finds a way of subverting cinematic techniques in themselves for the aim of achieving an illusion of even greater reality. So the duality between the demands of realism and the freedom of fantasy is the tension that generates what is, to my mind, still the most energetic and vigorous American filmmaking of our time. If you don't believe me, first listen to a young master, Ari Aster.
And I was on like a, you know, an anti-Spielberg kick, which is a very, like, it's a trap, I think, you get into when you're young, and then you get older, and it's like, oh, actually, Spielberg's the greatest ever. That's where I stand now. Spielberg is just as good as it gets.
And then listen to an old one, Sidney Lumet.
You know, because he's such a commercial success, people tend to denigrate Spielberg. I think he's maybe the best American director.
Spielberg belongs in that luminous company, and he kind of always did, even before we realized it. So clearly this video was meant to be done before West Side Story came out. Clearly that didn't happen, so I'll just have to say something about it here. It's really good. It'll probably make a nice double feature with The Fablemans, Spielberg's next movie. As I mentioned, he's returning to the 1950s of his childhood. Similarly, he's been wanting to make a musical for his entire career, and some of his least successful movies have been dogged by the fact that they may have been better as musicals, and while that might not necessarily be true, one might for that reason have dreaded Spielberg taking on West Side Story, as his musical aspirations haven't proven to be too successful in the past. I didn't have that dread. I always expected Spielberg's West Side Story to be good, and it is, even if it is very mindful of the original musical. As much as has been said about updating the material, it still remains extremely faithful in spirit. Spielberg treats it very much like the classic it is, which might make one leave with the impression that it's more a showcase of adaptational sobriety than a, you know, a burning passion to tell the story. Still, it's interesting in this sense that it falls in line with Spielberg's later career in that he chooses material that will allow him a certain degree of violence, though not going all the way. It seems to me that the thing West Side Story always needs is a sense of actual violence, true danger. And one can easily imagine Spielberg feeling that, yeah, what I can add to the classic Robert Wise version is a much more realistic sense of actual violence. Even the wonderful choreography has a much more, you know, jagged and fierce quality to it, which is entirely appropriate. And when the fighting comes, it definitely does feel harsh and the hits do land, but I still feel Spielberg could have let himself go even more. I think it probably probably should have been more violent. I think that would have made for an even more original movie musical. The elder Spielberg has this problem that he's still very much capable of the pure ferocity he has shown in the past, but that he curtails himself on that very point, which is at least as fascinating as it is occasionally frustrating. Anyway, see you at the next Spielberg movie. I hope and expect there to be lots more.